And I bet y'all missed this. We're going to go ahead and make a tail section, either tonight or today. I've got something else I'm working on that I really can't show on video yet. Hello, I'm Scott Brown with Green Wind and Other Home Energies. I'm up here at
Boomtown Laboratories, Louisville, by gosh, Texas.
This is the new wind turbine. There's going to be some changes to the framework. I want a fully furling mechanism, but for now, for testing, like this, I get to put it up into the wind and let it go straight on, see what it can take. That way we're sure of safety. This right here has another pipe that goes over it, two washes for the yaw bearing, and the tail will come off on the end. I've had to make a couple adaptations to it since I got it. Right here, it used to have metal coming down here, and it came with one rotor, but you gotta have two rotors to have the magnetics running from magnet, cross over to here, then over to here, then over to here. That's a full circle of magnetism. These two magnets become twice as strong because these are connected. As a matter of fact, when you take one of these plates off and you with the magnets on this side, you can stick it against something and you can't even tell it's got magnets on it. Turn it over the other side and you don't get your fingers out of the way, it might take them off. These magnets are 1 inch long, as you can see down here, 1 inch long, half inch wide by half inch thick. And they're 38 pounds of pull. And that's a lot of pull each. When you got 24 of them and they're facing each other, and like I said, this one's twice as strong because of this one here is added to it. And so that means each of them is twice as strong. That's a lot of pounds of pull. You don't want to get your fingers down in between them. Here's the prop mount. This is actually countersunk and screws set in this way, and on the back side they're set that way and set in. This comes up against the race of those bearings on the unit. The bearings are the same bearings that they use on ski lifts, and they're guaranteed for a real long time. I resanded this blade because I didn't quite get center when I drilled the hole and set it all up, and that is a flush mount. You can't feel the difference between the edge of the steel here and the hole. And so I just decided to sand the whole thing down and refinish it. That gave me a chance to get rid of some old sanding scratches that I left in there and didn't notice until I put the polyurethane and stain on it. So that blade's balanced and set up. I've had it on the wind turbine, spun it a few times. And over here, this side here is the side that goes against the that the nut goes onto right here, and that side here presses against the other side of the blade mount, and that holds her on there. Plus it's all the blade turns clockwise when you're creating power, as everything tightens up and will not slip. And this right here is my wire. It's an 18 gauge 200 degrees Celsius double enameled 18 gauge wire, copper, and it's set into the drill press. And to adjust the tension, you just raise the table till you get the right tension, then pulling off, and believe it or not, that's my coil winder. I start off with two nuts on this side and a wire pinched between it, wrapped around here a few times, and I wind it by hand with this. Real easy to count and go after. That's a quarter inch piece of copper tubing in the middle. Works real good. I cut the middle piece of copper to about an inch, and I put it on a piece of all thread with the nuts, two nuts turned against each other so it wouldn't turn. Put it on the belt sander at an angle and let this spin. It came out perfectly even and flat so that these two sides of the coil winder stay exactly the same distance apart. Then I did the same on the other side till I got to the length. Really easy to do. Cheap. This is nothing but, what gauge stud is this? 18 gauge stud. I sat there and just cut a couple pieces out and made sure that it was going to be as wide as the coil, so when it starts coming over the edges, I know I'm done. And I've got 300 turns on these coils. This was a test coil of what I thought I was going to be using. That was 88 turns. Didn't come up with the results I wanted. So here's the coil. That is 297 on that one. And I went ahead and did this one. And this is 300 turns. I kind of like that. 300 turns. Takes a little bit bigger, but it fills up the gap in the section where they're nice, sweet, smooth, even. It fills up the section here on the plan for where the coils are going to be. Stays within the parameters here and here, and same here. That was the shape of the old coil. This is the shape of the new coil. If they're a little bigger, if I move them just that far, no problem. But anyway, this is what we got. And this is going to be for sale pretty cheap. It's meant to help those that want to get into the wind and can't afford them bigger units. Mr. Belgrade Machine did the machine work on this and been very helpful. A lot of nice work. Well, we're going to get back to coil winding, and I'll see you later. I'm Scott Brown, Green Wind and Other Home Energies. Say hello to Boomer. Hello, Boomer.
Hi, folks. Alright, getting back onto here. The wires are going to wind up being on the outside, and these coils are going to be sitting inside their parameters. We're going to have to cast a stator. I made a few copies on the copy machine. 10 of them to be exact, just to make things a little easier and I can glue this down. Well, there we go. There's part of the mold. This is the center. Cut the outside first. Figure it's going to mount here. So I just pulled it up as one tab. And the other mount's going to be here and here. And I'm going to put three spots up here for the wires to go to. And then they'll run down the center of the unit. So I cut the outside circle first. Then I took the inside and cut one more right here on the router table. My measuring out so far. Got these. So this will be in the center of the mold. And this will be the outside of the mold. That will set in the middle. That'll give us just enough room to do everything. And as you can see, the bolts are going to clear quite a bit. So it's going to be pretty easy to work with. Should not have a problem. And the coils will butt pretty close up to it. And that's all right. That's fine by me. So I'm kind of happy with this. Sorry I haven't made much video. I'm trying to get this done quick rather than make it a series. Just kind of want to run through this. And basically to make it cheap enough, rather than having something that's overrated and says it's a 1.5 kilowatt wind turbine, I'm not going to rate mine for a 36 mile an hour wind. Well, anyway, a lot of them rate it for the size of the prop and a 36 mile an hour wind, but the unit's only 45% efficient, which means it's less than 750. And then we drop it down, we at a 36 mile an hour wind with a 97% efficient machine. We're kicking maybe 1.5 if we're lucky. Let's call it 1600 just to give everybody a little credit. And then we go down to an 18 mile an hour wind. And what you wind up with is 200 watts because as the wind speed doubles, your power goes up by a factor of 8. So as you go down half, it goes down by to 1/8. And let's say we leave 18 miles an hour, we go down to 9 miles per hour. Well, you got 25 watts. And that's what people get. They buy a 1.5 kilowatt wind turbine with a 5-foot prop, and they got 10 mile an hour winds and get 25 watts. And I wonder why. Well, I'm going to make this or less than that if it's not as efficient, and maybe you're winding up with 10 watts until the wind picks up. But anyway, this is it's not going to kick out 1.5 kilowatts because I'm not going to let it run up that high, and the wire is going to burn up if I do. But it's going to start up, and it's going to kick out in the lower winds, the everyday winds, the winds that everybody has. And it's going to be putting out a decent amount of power. And it's going to be very efficient. It's going to spin up early, and it's going to stay spinning in the lower winds. I'm Scott Brown, Green Wind and Other Home Energies. We'll get to casting here in a little bit.
All right, I'm working on the centerpiece of this. Well, seeing as a couple, when you look at plywood, it's got a few pieces of, a few of the layers of the plywood missing throughout somewhere in the middle. Anyway, of course, I put the aluminum foil tape on the outside. That way, those holes disappear. And I put it on like this and around, and you can see the bottom edge kind of peels, sticks out a little bit. That's going to help it seal. But I don't want too much on the edge. And the razor blade has a shape that's flat like this. And then it kind of comes in like that to the point. So it's not going to be right on the edge. I don't need all this excess. And if I fold it over, it's not going to set right. So I'm going to cut some of this edge around it. When I'm done and I'm ready to put it in the mold, everything is going to be sealed with axial grease. There we go. Pull in. Kind of wraps that edge a little bit. There we go. And the other side on the bottom, I think I'm going to do about the same thing. So letting it sit out. A little bit wider than the piece of wood. For some reason, it always tries to leave just a little hanging over. You can see the silver edge on this. There we go. Looking mighty nice. And if I go like this, smooth and flattens the edge out. That helps bring it in. There we go, and I'm done. Very nice. I even got an edge on both sides. Doing pretty good. Go like this to smooth it all out. Just as good as a metal mold, I guess. It kind of looks like it got pushed in a little bit. And then we'll just put a little extra axle grease there. Mighty nice. My center's done. Put a screw dead center of that. That ought to work. I was thinking of using one of the 1/4-inch thick 12-inch round metal plates we have that we were going to make axial pluggers with for the bottom, but I decided I'm just going to go ahead and use the wood. That way I can take it home and I don't have to drill into that hardened steel. So we're basically done here. Next clip.